everyone, and welcome back to Unforgotten Tech. My name is Gregory Krause, and today we're going to be talking about disc brake rotors. We're going to be talking about what a disc brake rotor is, how they work, how to properly measure them, and find out if we can reuse them, resurface them, or we have to discard them. And last, we're going to be going over a step-by-step tutorial on how to resurface a brake rotor. Now, before we get started on resurfacing brake rotors today, if you could take a moment to like and subscribe to the channel, and if you have any questions or comments, please throw them in the comment section below. Brake rotors are circular discs, most commonly made from cast iron, that sit between brake pads on each of the wheels. The rotor's primary purpose is to slow down the turning of the car's wheels by utilizing friction. This is done when pressure is transferred from the driver's foot to the caliper pistons, causing the brake pads to press against the rotors, thus slowing down or stopping the vehicle. Due to this friction, rotors will wear out and need to be resurfaced or replaced. Unlike many maintenance items on a vehicle, brakes and rotors don't have a set interval to be serviced at. Instead, they must be periodically checked at regular service intervals or when there's a suspected concern. This is because brake wear speed primarily has to do with the type of driving and driver braking habits. A vehicle rotor can last tens of thousands of miles or become worn in one single emergency stop depending on the conditions. Concerns a customer may have that could be related to a brake rotor that's worn out is vibration, squeaking, or grinding when braking. When performing a visual inspection on rotors, we'll want to look for signs of wear, such as grooves worn into the rotor, excessive lateral runout, heat cracks, or bluing of the rotors. All right, now that we know what a disc brake rotor is, how it works, and why they wear out, let's go ahead and go over how to properly resurface a rotor. Now, before we can do that, we will need our PPE and equipment ready. For PPE, we'll need safety glasses, we'll need closed-toed shoes, and we'll need to be free of any loose clothing, hair, or jewelry. For tools and equipment, we'll need an outside micrometer, we'll need an emery cloth, we'll need a brake lathe, and we'll also need soap and water and a brush to clean the rotor with. The first step in resurfacing a disc brake rotor is to measure the rotor and make sure that we have enough material on it to remove some without compromising the safety of the rotor. To find the minimum specification of the rotor, you can find it inside the hat of the rotor on the side of it, or you can look it up on your online service guide. Checking out our rotor here, we can see that the minimum specification is written in 26 millimeters. When we convert that, it comes out to 1.024. We're going to take our outside micrometer here and make a measurement using the rotor. We're going to make sure that it's not nice and secure, but not too snug. And that's going to give us our measurement of 1.100. When we subtract the minimum specification from our actual measurement, we'll find that we have 0.085 of an inch that's left. This will work out pretty nicely, as most of the time when you're resurfacing a rotor, you'll find it that you're taking off roughly between 5/1000ths and 15/1000ths of an inch of material. Now, mind you, you want to keep about 30/1000ths of an inch of material left on the rotor just to account for wear while the rotor's on the vehicle. Now that we've verified that we have enough material on the brake rotor to remove some material without going under the minimum specifications, we're going to start setting up our AMCO brake lathe. We will do this by making sure the arbor shaft is clean and clear of debris, along with any mating surfaces such as the cups, rotor, or backing plate. Any excessive rust on the rotor will need to be cleaned if it will affect the mounting of the rotor. Now that we have our brake lathe cleaned, prepped, and ready to go, we can start to mount our disc brake rotor. The first part we're going to need to be able to mount the disc brake rotor is going to be our mounting flange. The mounting flange has a divot that holds the spring in the middle to keep it centered, and it also is going to be the one that fits in the middle here without touching the corners. So we want it to be a smooth fit in here without wedging up against the corners of the hat. We're going to go ahead and put this on first with the spring followed, And then the next part we're going to be putting is our centering cone. Our centering cone needs to fit in the middle without falling through and making sure that at least a portion of it goes in. And this will keep our rotor centered during the process. This will go with the taper side back. And now our rotor can go on. Make sure the hat side is facing out. We will now grab our outside flange. Our outside flange is considerably heavy. This is to help reduce vibration. You'll also notice there's a rubber portion in the middle, which also will cause it to absorb vibrations. We're gonna take the large open portion and put that in towards the rotor. And we're gonna push it in all the way. Now, we'll want to place our spacers. Our spacers, the first one we have, is going to have a rubber center. This rubber center is so that we can increase the dampening of vibrations. Depending on how much space, we may need to use another spacer. And then we can install our arbor nut. Our arbor nut has two different sides that you can use, one that will take it deeper in on the threads and the other one a little more shallow. Now, unlike most bolts, this is going to be a left side thread. So it's going to be righty, loosey, lefty, tighty. Now we can use our brake lathe wrench and tighten up our setup. Our brake lathe wrench is specifically to our lathe and the combination will fit the nut on the arbor and on top. Vibration elimination is crucial to the process. This will be needed to keep an even, smooth resurfacing without chattering. We already installed our heavy flange, adding mass to our setup, and we installed the vibration dampener rubber splitter spacer. Now we will want to add one more vibration dampener, which will be our vibration strap. Now that we are confident in our arbor setup, we can set up the facing tool. First, we will loosen the locks and back off the cutters. While backing off the cutters, we will want to make sure that they are even on both sides. We will now loosen the nut on the facing tool and position the tool in a position that will allow the rotor to move up the middle of the cutters. We will then tighten the nut back up with the proper position. So now we have everything set up, ready to go and resurface this rotor. But before we get started, we're going to take a step back from the machine. We're going to take a look and do a brief inspection to make sure everything's where it should be and connected how it's supposed to be. We'll be checking all of the cutting tools, the arm, the rotor itself, and also ourselves to make sure we don't have anything hanging that could become dangerous by being sucked into the machine. We want to turn on the machine and make sure everything is moving correctly. Now that everything looks good and ready to start, we will use the adjustment wheel to move the cutting tools halfway into the rotor's surface. We will adjust the cutters until the very second they touch the rotor's surface. This is called a scratch cut. In this adjustment, we are finding our zero mark to reference our rotor's cuts with. We have zeroed our cutters on both sides and can now move the cutter all the way to the inside of the rotor's surface, past the surface where the braking pads will ride on. We will now move the cutting bits onto the rotor's surface, making sure that we take care as one can get their fingers stuck and sucked inside the tool during this maneuver. This is 3 notches or 3/1000ths of an inch. A depth of 2/1000ths to 6/1000ths of an inch is what's recommended for a minimum and maximum depth when resurfacing. Everything is now set up and ready to make a cut. We will engage the machine by first pulling the lever towards us. This will have the machine perform a fast cut for our initial cut. This cut will take a minute or two, but will go rather quickly. We will disengage the lathe, turn off the machine, and inspect the rotor. You will notice that the rotor is not perfectly smooth and still has some noticeable grooves. This is because we have still one more cut to go. We'll then move the cutting tool back using the front wheel, loosen our cutter locks, and move each side in at least 2/1000ths of an inch for our final cut. When the cutters are in position and the locks are engaged, we will push the lever away from us to engage the lathe for a slow cut. This will take several minutes to do. During this time, we want to make sure we are watching the machine and listening for any issues or concerns in the process. Being responsible for this machine while using it will keep others from coming too close and make sure they are safe. Things to note while using the brake lathe is that depending on the rotor, you may need to make more than two cuts or take off more than 2/1000ths inch of material to be true out of the rotor. However, no matter how much material we take off, we must have a rotor in which the minimum is not crossed. Before removing the rotor after the final cut, you should re-measure the rotor's thickness to confirm and document your measurements. We will now remove the rotor, clean up the brake lathe, and return all of the equipment. The last step on the resurfacing the rotors will be to scuff up the new surface using an emery cloth, then wash your rotor with warm soap and water. This will allow for a clean surface to brake in properly with the new brake pads. All right, just to recap, today we learned about disc brake rotors. We learned what a disc brake rotor was, why we need them, how they work. We learned how to properly measure them and when we can keep them, resurface them, or we have to discard them. And last, we went over a full tutorial about how to resurface a disc brake rotor. Well, my name is Gregory Krause from Unforgotten Tech, and I want to thank each and every one of you for tuning in today. And remember, be strong, believe, be unforgotten.